Brooklyn Independent Television.
Hello, welcome to Neighborhood Beat, your passport to Brooklyn. I'm your host, Aaron Watkins, and today we're back in beautiful Williamsburg and Greenpoint. In this episode, we'll learn about green places for small spaces at Sprout Home and test our linguistic skills at Fluent Brooklyn. Next, we'll get inspired and pumped up at Green Fitness Studio before we sample succulent savory steaks at Amber's Steakhouse and Meat Market. Stay tuned. Over the years, the streets of Williamsburg and Greenpoint have graced big and small screens alike. Several scenes from Coming to America were shot here in the 1980s. The apartment where Eddie Murphy and Arsenio Hall stayed, as well as the barbershop where he cut his princely lock, were actually shot on Hooper Street in Williamsburg. HBO's Boardwalk Empire shot on a vacant lot at Commercial and Clay Streets in northern Greenpoint. And FX's Damages has also shot in the neighborhood. Do you often feel like the city is closing in around you? Well, fear not. The concrete jungle has nothing on the luscious greenery created right here. To sprout means to grow and come forth. And that's exactly what Sprout Home is helping city dwellers to do. They turn itty-bitty little apartments into zen spaces and create urban gardens out of the drabbest locales.
My name is Tassie DeGive, and we're at Sprout Home Brooklyn. Sprout Home is a modern home and garden store, and we also do cut flowers as well. The idea of Sprout Home started in Chicago back in 2003, just to kind of fill an empty hole that, you know, there were no garden centers basically in the area that we started at. When I moved to Brooklyn, I noticed a similar kind of, you know, need for a garden center.
As a floral designer, I help purchase the weekly flowers for the store, for the customers. I handle the weekly accounts and meet with brides and just everyday neighborhood customers that walk in and want a bouquet. Some brides come in and they're really thorough and exact, exactly what they want. And then you get other brides who are all over the place and really need some more direction being led.
We offer free classes for the public. It's a pretty broad range of plant classes, and we just try to teach them basically everything we know about how to take care of plants. So whenever anyone's checking out, we always ask, do you know how to take care of this plant? Do you know the lighting? Do you know the water requirements? And we also sell, you know, indoor plant books, outdoor plant books. So we try to really give a broad range of information.
I discovered Sprout a couple years ago when I moved to the neighborhood and had a backyard. And so started buying all the plants I could get. Generally, I'm drawn to architectural plants, really clean, hard lines, instead of like the big leafy plants. I prefer the more sort of rigid looking ones.
So in Brooklyn, we all know there's barely any space for plants. So what we have here are some Wally Pockets that we get from Wooly Pockets Company, which is a pocket made out of wool, suitable for indoor or outside that you could just install on your wall. And basically, depending on what kind of lighting you have and the plants you choose, they're super low maintenance and a great way to just create like a living wall for your space. Also, another great way to create like a vertical kind of garden are glass bubble terrariums that are wall mounted, and you could actually just plant in them directly also and create visual terrariums. We also offer many other terrariums that are more for tabletops and display. So I'm gonna show you them right over here. Here are some of the examples of terrariums that we carry at Sprout Home. These really cool, unusual double bubble terrarium that are perfect for succulents or any kind of low plants. In this particular terrarium, it's a recycled bubble, great for any kind of succulents or lower light plants that we carry also. And this particular terrarium that we have, it's enclosed, so usually we do kind of like a mossy or ferny kind of plant inside. One of the coolest items we have here at Sprout Home are the talensias, also known as the air plants. You can see that there are a lot of different varieties, and they come in a lot of different sizes. I feel like the coolest way to display them are in these pot containers that we carry, and you could just kind of hang them from your window. They do need bright light and just kind of like a little bit of misting and soaking about once or twice a week. Some of the coolest plants we have here are the carnivorous plants. And as you can see here, we have the sundew, the Venus flytraps, and we also have the pitcher plant. We also have the hanging pitcher plant, which is really cool because they catch insects by kind of drowning them in a little bit of water inside the pod. With all this information, these are actually really easy plants to take care of, and they could get rid of your little insect problems in your apartment.
I've lived in Williamsburg for 5 years now. I love this neighborhood because it's growing so quickly. I feel the community has grown with restaurants and shops, and it's all independent.
You know, there's a lot of gardeners here, there's a lot of community gardens, so I knew that it would be something where people, you know, liked plants, wanted to be around plants.
My absolute favorite thing about Sprout is the selection, and then the people that work here. Everyone's really helpful. Leads me to make the right decisions because I know nothing.
We get really nice people and down to earth and just good customers, good clients.
So it's really nice, you know, they'll get their seeds from us and then they'll get soil and then they'll get pots and they're, you know, people come back and they're like, oh, my plant grew, I need a bigger pot and a bigger pot. And so it's really exciting. We're at 44 Grand Street in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, and that's between Kent and Wythe, and our floral studio is at 48 Grand Street.
Williamsburg has a long history of famous residents, including singer-songwriter Barry Manilow, whose hit song Copacabana won a Grammy in 1979. Gene Simmons of Kiss rock and roll fame, Benjamin Bugsy Siegel was born here in 1906, and novelist Henry Miller, who is famous for his book Tropic of Cancer. Bonjour, walaikum assalam, guten tag, ciao, hola. Have you ever wanted to learn French? Or maybe check out Carnival in Brazil, or maybe a bullfight in Barcelona? Whether you're planning a trip abroad, or you just want to test out your new language skills in the international land that is Brooklyn, this is the place to start, practice, learn, and grow. This is Fluent Brooklyn. Bonjour.
The way that Fluent Brooklyn is set up is a place where it's the base for you to study that language. The core of our business are our classes, and our workshops and trips are meant to be extra bonuses. Trips are obviously expensive, so a lot of people can't afford them. Going to France to study French for a week with a Fluent Brooklyn professor is awesome, but we understand it's very expensive. So we also try to do things like workshops very specific to a certain topic. For example, our slang workshops are extremely popular. Our classes tend to focus a lot more on slang than traditional classes do, or the kind of French that you're learning, for example, would be the kind of French you'd actually use in here on the street, whereas a slang workshop is dedicated solely to that.
So the type of students that are in our classes are really, people about my age, people who are looking to, you know, brush up on their French or whatever language and have something to do at night other than just going to the bar. And it's really people who are interested in brushing up on French they've had already, or people that really want to take their French to the next level.
Ça veut dire que beaucoup de gens veulent y aller. C'est attirant.
Oh, comme attractive.
Exactement. Comme attractive.
Well, I wanted to learn French because I really love a lot of 60s French pop and 60s French film. So I've been enchanted by that for a while, and I thought it was about time to learn a little bit of French myself.
Knowing how to speak Italian and knowing how to teach Italian are two different battles, which I've been challenged with and really been happily challenged with. Speaking it started back in the day when I was in high school. Took a foreign exchange for 1 year. I said, I want to go to Italy. They said, you're going to go to an island called Sardinia. When I showed up here, I found this bridge between something I spontaneously fell into speaking, which was an awesome language, and a way I could constantly, you know, be forced to be a better speaker of it through teaching it.
The first day of level one is like the first day of kindergarten, because you learn numbers, you learn the days of the week, you learn how to say your name is, you learn how to say hello, like the really basic things. And it's really fun, just like the first day of kindergarten, because everyone's excited, everyone's happy to be there, they're just, you know, it's the first day of a new journey, of a new learning journey that everybody's going on.
Pero ella comparte la apartamento, el apartamento con tres gatos.
At Fluent Brooklyn, the main idea is that we offer classes, especially beginner classes, taught by non-native speakers on purpose. Being a non-native speaker myself and teaching French made me realize, through seeing a lot of the successes of my students, that it's very helpful when you start to begin the extreme basics of learning a foreign language to have someone who also learned it themselves teach it to you.
My favorite part about the learning experience is that I think learning a new language can be really intimidating. By taking a French class by actually a non-native speaker, I found that to be really reassuring and encouraging, because he was able to give us tips about areas that he initially was struggling with and where we can then benefit from those sort of tips that you might not necessarily get from a native speaker.
A native speaker, for example, even being a very experienced teacher, might not realize and really sympathize with how difficult a sound can be, or how difficult understanding why in French you say I have coldness as opposed to I am cold. It's just an inherent part of them that even experienced teachers don't necessarily think about, and if nothing else, don't really have the sympathy for. Even a patient experienced teacher has a hard time with that.
My name is Sebastian Almada. I'm the manager of Green Fitness Studio. This fitness studio is located in 232 Virus Street in Brooklyn, New York. Studio was created like 2 years ago. The owner, Barry Borgen, and one of his top managers, Simon, they were thinking about in doing something different for the neighborhood. Well, they were talking about making a gym, but how can you make a gym different, you know, from the others? All gyms are pretty much the same. So this is how this concept came out. We are all about being eco-friendly. We do our best. We definitely are trying every day to improve our facilities and to be more eco-friendly and be more efficient.
We have the community coming in and checking in and connecting based on, you know, treating themselves well. And you start with you first, and then you can extend all of that gratitude outward to your community. In a fitness setting, I think the whole idea generally is saying that we have to and absolutely must begin to pay attention to our environment, because it gives us everything we have, so we should, you know, honor that.
Now I'm going to show you why we are green. As you can see here, the floor is made out of old tires. It's recycled. We have refurbished machines that we build ourselves. We paint them with powder coating, which is more eco-friendly than regular paint. It's a powder that you put over the surface, and then you put it inside an oven, for an oven that is set up at 500 Fahrenheit degrees. First of all, we have a bamboo floor, which is very flexible. It reaches maturity it takes like 3 to 10 years to reach maturity. Then you have the glasses. It's transparent. You get all the sunlight coming in from the east every morning, so it helps us to not to use a heater as much, since we capture the energy that the sunlight brings. But as soon as you start pedaling, it's going to turn on by itself. It's going to take much more effort to actually pedaling, and you're going to feel the pressure. But basically what we do here is that we are using the energy that you generate yourself.
You don't have to plug this machine to any outlets at all. Sunlight is coming in from the east, so we really don't use as much energy as you could if everything would be covered with a wall, for instance. So we use fluorescent lights, fluorescent bulbs, so you're saving energy as well. You have the sauna, which is an infrared sauna. It takes, it's about 40 to 50% more energy efficient than any other sauna that you're going to find. So you're using less energy all the time, which is very important if you're trying to not to have such a huge impact in the environment. Okay, well, this is one of my favorite machines. It's a water rowing machine. This little monitor right here is solar powered. That means that it gets our energy from the sun, since we get all the sunlight coming in from the east every morning. It's filled up with water here, so it actually gives you the effect that you're actually rowing.
Well, I mean, I think it matters in any sort of profession. I mean, this just happens to be the fitness industry, but, you know, I mean, there's a lot of people on this earth, and unless we start taking care of it better, I mean, it's not going to be there, you know, 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now. So whether you're working in a gym, whether you're working in a, you know, for a corporation, it doesn't matter. Getting greener is something we all need to do to save our environment, to save this planet.
Wellness is not just physically, it's something spiritual as well. So not only because of the yoga, you know, classes that every other gym has, but we also make, for instance, art exhibitions. Because this is a growing community made out of artists. We give them a place where they can, you know, show their work. We give them a place so they can expand their boundary.
We have a national kosher certification that makes us kosher and non-kosher. We have the certificates here for Verde Juice Bar, and as also we have the certificate for Green Fitness Studio as well.
I think this green movement is going to help us to understand more what's going on in the world, actually. I think it's very important for us to be conscious about our impact in the environment. I think it's very important as well to be conscious about what we can do to improve our, you know, our ideas and to improve our way of being. Right now, we are going to make Don Rickle juice. Part of what the future looks like. The future is demanding something from us that is being more conscious about what's going on in the world, what is our impact in nature, what is our impact in our own community. So I think it's something that is going to be part of the future's ideology. Actually, this is the first time that I'm tasting Don Rickle made from Francine. Cheers. Well, actually, it's really good. It's amazing.
Roasted beet carpaccio, Bavarian pork shank. Today, the filet mignon. This weekend, definitely the porterhouse for two. Nestled on the corner of Nassau Avenue and Eckford Street, Amber Steakhouse and Meat Market is the place to go for great steak, upscale cuisine, and authentic Polish goodies like Grandma used to make. Let's check it out.
My name is Lucas Grotsky, and I'm the owner's son. I've been around the business for since I was a little kid, since 6 years old. Amber Steakhouse is the first steakhouse in Greenpoint. We opened a restaurant April 16th of 2009. My dad was a chef in Poland, and he opened up the meat market next door, and he's always good at meat.
I'm from Skoda Wielka, near the city of Lomża in Poland. When I came to the U.S. in 1993, I worked for 5 years in a meat market, and then the Podlasie meat market was for sale, so I bought it. I built this building with a plan that this space would become a restaurant. And that if I opened a restaurant, I wanted to open a high-quality restaurant, a steakhouse, because there wasn't one in this neighborhood.
My name is Patrick Czenczek, and I'm a chef at Amber Steakhouse. Polish kitchen doesn't have any influence in this kitchen. It's all about the steaks and the seafood. I'm gonna grill for you guys ribeye without the bone. I'm gonna put some sea salt. All sides, nice. Press it down. A little bit of fresh black pepper. Flip it. Season it. Now it's ready to go. The grill. Nice and hot. 1700 Fahrenheit. But it's gonna take a little while, you know. Alright, let's check this guy. Steak is ready. Nice. It's medium rare. Put this in the plate. Finish it with the melted butter. Nice flavor. Not too much. And it's done. Ready to go.
It's one of the best preparation what you can get in this restaurant. I mean, that's always nice and clean. And of course, the best taste. Almost every day I'm here and I enjoy, you know, food.
This is the cooler where we aging the steak. Nice marbles over here. York strip already, nice, dry.
I had T-bone steak, which was awesome. And let's see, I had the tuna tartare appetizer, which was really good. And the baked potato, and can't beat it. It was great.
Okay, we're gonna make tuna tartare. First, we're gonna small dice tuna. Should be enough for one order. Now we're gonna put this to the bowl. I'm gonna cut some red pepper, small dice. Should be enough. We got some chili to spice it up. Toasted sesame seeds, black and white, a little bit of sea salt, black pepper. We're gonna add in some cilantro. Now we got dressing for the tuna, around 2 teaspoons combined together. We got orange yuzu reduction on the plate. And then I'm gonna use the ring. I'm gonna cut some avocado. And now we're gonna add some mango dice, small, on the top of avocado. Tuna tartare. Now we're gonna put in some toast. We're gonna take out the ring. Water crisp. And to the finish, we got topico. My tuna tartare.
About the owner, I can say a lot. It's a very good thing what he did for this neighborhood. It's a guy who, you know, started from zero and another business and finally got the idea to open one of the best restaurant steakhouse in Brooklyn, I should say.
How's everything going? You guys enjoying yourselves? Now we're at the meat market. These are products over here. Sauerkraut, pickles, jam, sweet stuff, and all these drinks that are imported from Poland. And over here we have our homemade product, the kielbasa, and then we have products over here that are cooked by the back, krokety. Over here we have things that are made by the back by my grandmother. It's soup, gołąbki, sałatka. Our main thing is smoked fish. My father is really good in smoked fish. He goes to the market almost every single day, gets fish, eel, lake trout, salmon, catfish. Also over here we have our pierogies. We also have nalashiki, it's with cheese. It's like a pancake kind of thing. And pizza, of course. And over here we have herring. Pretty good. This is where my grandmother, she prepares all the stuff. The pierogies, the sałatki, all the stuff I showed you before in front of the store. My grandma, she's preparing, she's cutting things up. And then I'll show you the butcher in the back. He's preparing all the stuff so we can do the kielbasa, the hams, all the stuff that I showed you guys in front. He's been the guy that's getting everything ready.
Greenpoint is changing very quickly.
I've lived here since 93, and in the last 5 years, it became very American. And that's why Polish businesses, kielbasy, and other things won't be as popular as in the past. But this restaurant, I think, will be here for a long time.
The business is going better and better every day. It's more people coming Saturdays, Sundays, parties. It's really getting really good. And the word around the street is that the restaurant is, the food is really good, quality is good. So we're doing pretty good.
Well, that does it for this episode of Neighborhood Beat, your passport to Brooklyn. I hope my visit will inspire you to grab your friends and check out these fantastic communities for yourself. For more information on the Neighborhood Beat series or to watch past episodes of the show online, visit us on the web at brickartsmedia.org/BIT. And you can now find us on YouTube and iTunes, keyword BK Independent TV. I'm your host, Aaron Watkins. Onwards and upwards, Brooklyn.
Watching the BCAT TV Network.